Langstroth type beehive is the most important and most used hive type in the United States, and for that matter, it's gaining in popularity around the world. A lot of beekeepers will use hive types that are based on Langstroth's design in other countries. Here in the United States, I would say most production colonies are the Langstroth type hive. Before I go too far with this, I do acknowledge that there are plenty of other hive types, and I do recognize that beekeeper preferences vary. It's perfectly okay with me if you want to use other types of beehives, but for practicality's sake, it's easier for me to discuss the hive type that's really the most used here in the US and many parts of the world. So why do we call it the Langstroth type hive? Well, Langstroth is actually the last name of L.L. Langstroth or Lorenzo Lorraine Langstroth. Langstroth was a minister who worked with bees and made two observations about bee biology that revolutionized beekeeping. The first observation that he made was really revolutionary. What Lorenzo Lorraine Langstroth discovered is that bees tend to space their combs around 3/8 of an inch from another comb. That's about 9.5 millimeters. So what does that mean? Well, if you give bees less than 3/8 of an inch space, they will put propolis in that gap. The gap is really small, they'll propolize it. If you give bees more than 3/8 of an inch, they'll actually build another comb in that space. If you give bees exactly 3/8 of an inch, they build neither comb nor put propolis, so they will allow that space to maintain. That's why we call it bee space. So the internal dimensions of the Langstroth hive is based on 3/8 of an inch or 9.5 millimeters. The reason that's so critical is because with that spacing, the bees won't build comb or propolis, which allows us to take these boxes apart, but more importantly, it allows us to take these frames out of the hive as well as put those frames back into the hive. I cannot emphasize enough the importance of bee space. Everything in this hive is built with those dimensions in mind, which make this hive workable. The second discovery that Langstroth made was also very important. He discovered that when given the choice, feral and wild honeybee colonies that are looking for a nest cavity to move into to build their comb tend to choose nest cavities that are about 40 liters or roughly 10 gallons in volume. So when Langstroth developed the box that he used as his standard box in the hive, he developed what we call the deep hive body that happens to be, you guessed it, 40 liters in volume. With bee space and the volume cavity that bees prefer in mind, Langstroth developed a hive type that is very similar to what you see here. So I'm going to walk my way through this hive from top to bottom and explain to you the different parts that compose the typical Langstroth hive. Starting at the top, every hive has a lid. The purpose of the lid on a hive is to keep out the inclement weather, the sunshine, and to make sure that the inner cavity of the hive is dry and that the bees are able to thermoregulate. This particular lid is called a telescoping lid because it comes out over the edges of the box. It telescopes over the edges of that box. When you use a telescoping lid, you will always use a second lid underneath it. That lid is called the inner lid, or more commonly, the inner cover. Why do you need an inner cover when you already have a lid? Well, it's really simple. Bees are going to put propolis between the frames in this box and the inner cover. And as a result, you're going to need a hive tool to be able to pry that apart. If you didn't have this inner cover, you just take it off of the hive and you put this telescoping cover on top of this box, the bees are going to glue the frames to the telescoping cover. And since the telescoping cover telescopes over the edges of the box, your hive tool cannot go under that telescoping cover and turn a corner to pop those frames from the lid. So if you ever use a telescoping cover, you're always going to use an inner cover to ensure that you're able to take that lid off of the frames. So as I remove this inner cover, you'll see it usually has two features. The first of those is a hole in the middle. This hole accommodates a small, kind of obscure piece of beekeeping equipment called a bee escape that you can put here. Bees can go through the hole one way, but not the other way. So sometimes beekeepers will use these inner covers between boxes to cause the bees to go one way through them, but not back into them, so it's a way to empty a box with bees. That's less commonly done these days, but you'll still see this inner cover having a hole in all inner covers that you purchase. The second characteristic you'll see is that there is a notch cut into this inner cover, and some beekeepers believe it's important for upward ventilation or to allow bees a second entrance towards the top of the hive. Now, as you work with beehive types and configurations, you're going to discover that there's many, many different pieces of equipment. I showed you the telescoping cover and inner cover, but there's also a migratory lid, like what you see here, that is very common in the commercial beekeeping world, and it is simply a lid that fits flush on the uppermost box of the hive. The reason they call it migratory lid, this lid allows you to stack hives close to one another so that you can put a lot of them on the back of a truck. Remember, if you had a telescoping lid, it would gap here. The next hive would have a telescoping lid and gap here, and then you'd have dead space between the hives of about that much. So a lot of commercial beekeepers have moved away from the telescoping cover, not the least of which reason is it's easier to stack more bees together, but it's also requiring you to purchase two pieces of equipment, both the telescoping cover or lid and the inner cover, and instead have moved in favor of these migratory lids that again fit flush on this box. The second thing you'll notice about this migratory lid, in addition to being flush around the edges of this box, is that it has a hole in it. And that hole is a way that you can feed your bees with an inverted jar through this lid. More on that in another episode. Here comes the most difficult part. Beekeeping is full of jargon, and we've gotten now to the part of the hive that's called so many different things. You've heard me with regularity up until this point talking about the Langstroth hive being composed of different boxes. Well, that's true. This is a box. This is a box. And there is actually a third size box that's slightly smaller than this box that's painted red here on this hive. This lowermost box is the largest, or the larger of the two boxes. This one we would call the deep box. This one, knowing that it's the middle of the three box sizes, I would call the medium box. And then there is a third box size called the shallow box. It's the smallest of the three. Well, these boxes also go by names of supers. The prefix super, S-U-P-E-R, when added to a word, means above. Supers got their name by adding the next box above the previous one. So, some beekeepers would call this a deep super, this one a medium super, and the third size a shallow super. Some beekeepers in the United States call the medium super an Illinois super, and a lot of commercial beekeepers simply refer to them as honey supers. Usually when you say honey super, you mean the medium or the shallow, because the deep box is almost exclusively used in the brood area for the queen to lay eggs and for them to take care of their young. So I'm going to progress through this style of boxes, probably referring to this as a medium super because it would be used for honey, and this one as the deep brood box, or more commonly called the brood chamber. So this then is a medium super, and the purpose of this box in this hive configuration is for honey storage. So this super contains 10 frames. The frame that goes into the super would be named after the super, so this is a medium frame that goes into the medium super. And this wooden frame has four sides and a second piece of equipment in it called foundation. If you just had a medium super full of empty frames, the bees would build comb whatever direction they wanted to build comb. So as beekeepers, we have to coerce bees to put the comb in the frame to make their comb movable, and we do that by having foundation in the frame, giving them a head start on where we want them to put that comb. So this medium super accommodates 10 frames, and if I remove it from the nest and set it on top of my lids, we'll get down to another fairly standard piece of equipment that is called the queen excluder. One of the things I like about beekeeping is things are often called exactly what they do. So this device, being called the queen excluder, you might guess excludes the queen from certain areas of the nest. So the fact that there was a queen excluder here means that you could put the queen here and she could not end up in your medium super. So how does that work? Well, the queen excluder is a grid system where worker bees, which are the smallest bees in the nest, can go up and down through the grid, but queens, being too large, cannot go through this grid. So wherever the queen is in these boxes, when you add the queen excluder, you're going to trap her either below the excluder or above the excluder. And beekeepers often use this to keep the queen in the lowermost box, i.e. the brood chamber or the brood box, and out of the upper boxes, the honey supers. And of course, there are plastic excluders and wooden-bound excluders, all types of excluders. This one is a metal-bound excluder, which is common for what we use here at the University of Florida. Now we are down to the lowermost box in this hive, and this is the deepest box, so it's a deep brood box or a deep brood chamber. And like the medium super, it also accommodates 10 frames. And like the medium super, the frame that goes in it would be named after the box from which it came, so this would be a deep frame that has a sheet of foundation that goes into this deep frame. This frame happens to be wooden, but increasingly so, you can find frames that are made out of other material. This frame is plastic, its foundation is plastic, and it's molded as a single piece. So in beekeeping, there are lots of different types of things that you can use to build your hives, but this particular brood box or brood chamber has 10 frames, and this is where the queen likely would be put to lay eggs and for the bees to rear their young. So the last piece of a standard Langstroth hive is the bottom board, and to get to it, I'll remove this deep brood box. And now we can focus here on this bottom board. The bottom board is what it sounds like. It's the bottommost part of the beehive. The rest of the hive rests on it, and you'll notice that this bottom board has three walls. That is so that when you put a box on top of it, there will remain an entrance or an opening towards the front of that bottom board. This will become the colony's opening or entrance. And just like there are other types of these pieces of equipment, there's also a different type of bottom board that's very popular today, and that is the screen bottom board, because it is screened on the bottom rather than solid like the traditional bottom board. And the advantage here is that screen bottom boards can help reduce some of the pest populations that you can get into honeybee colonies. But like its solid bottom board constituent, it has three walls and a natural opening here at the front when you start stacking boxes. So keeping bees in these various hive components can be confusing, but I hope I've demystified some of the jargon surrounding beehives, specifically the Langstroth style hive, for you.